This video will not describe traditional and well-known methods. For example, I will not describe this Danish solar collector with this additional polymer film, which significantly increases the collector efficiency if it must produce heat of high temperatures. This type of solar collector forms the world's largest solar thermal station, which produces heat for the district heating of the Danish city of Silkeborg. Or for example, we understand that reducing the distance between the spikes of the absorber of a solar collector increases its efficiency. Therefore, we can come up with the idea of this solar collector with this absorber, which was made in Finland from 2 thin sheets of stainless steel. Or we can come up with the idea of this homemade absorber, which should be placed under a glass sheet, and now I show how that absorber was made of steel sheets. So, I will not talk about traditional methods. For example, about radical increase in efficiency of a collector due to selective coating of its absorber, or about increasing the thickness of the thermal insulation of the nose wall of a collector. However, this video will describe a ranking of the following 5 non-traditional methods, from the least effective to the simplest and most effective method. We know about this solar panel rotation systems according to the movement of the sun across the sky from morning to evening. A similar system is called a tracker, and it increases the electricity production from its solar panels by 20, 30 or 40%. These percentages can be noticeably greater for cases where a solar collector is installed on such a tracker, especially for cases of a large temperature difference between the liquid inside solar collector pipes and the ambient air. It is interesting that trackers of a large solar station cost several tens of dollars per square meter, and this is only 10 or 20% of the cost of a traditional solar collector. Also, small trackers can cost more than $100 per square meter. So, it may seem to us that installing solar collectors on such trackers makes good economic sense for cases of a cheap tracker, and if the cost of our solar collectors is more than $100 per square meter. But we must understand that traditional trackers are designed for lightweight panels and not for heavier solar collectors, and their summer effect is noticeably greater than in winter. We know about such air solar heaters, where solar radiation can heat air to almost 100 degrees Celsius. We also remember this solar collector from Finland, and it has this absorber for heating liquid. In addition, the Finnish collector has this fan for circulating ambient air through the space between the absorber and the glass sheet, and maybe also through the space under the absorber. So, we have the opportunity to connect the Finnish collector with an air solar heater, which will heat air for its circulation through the Finnish collector. Obviously, the hot air will increase the efficiency of the Finnish collector, because it will reduce heat losses from the collector through its glass sheet. In addition, the hot air can transfer heat from the air solar heater to the absorber of the Finnish collector. The economic sense of this idea is based on the fact that our solar collector is many times more expensive than the air solar heater, which increases the efficiency of our collector by several tens of percent. Now I will show 4 of my experiments, which measure the efficiency of this simpler version of our idea, but without the fan. This part is our solar air heater, and this part is our solar collector, which uses this polymer absorber to heat water. My first experiment measured the efficiency of this homemade solar collector, where that absorber was covered with a transparent polyethylene film. This is the first experiment, when the collector heated 26 liters of water of the tank from 22 degrees to 69 degrees Celsius for 2 hours. 1 hour later, the temperature of those 26 liters increased to almost 79 degrees. This is the idea of the second experiment, when this black film should heat air, which rises here, to give its heat to that black absorber for water. It turned out that now the black absorber produces 14% more heat compared to the first experiment. Unfortunately, the thickness of the air gap under the transparent film was only 5 cm, and therefore the air transferred its heat to the absorber very poorly. This is my third experiment, when I added this wooden stick with a length of 25 cm, and therefore now the hot air better goes up to the absorber. This fact noticeably increased the efficiency of the absorber, and now it produces 24% more heat than it was in the first experiment. This is my fourth experiment, where the thickness of the air gap under the transparent film is 15 cm, and this is 3 times more than it was in the case of the second experiment. This graph shows how the thermal capacity of my solar collector decreased due to an increase in this temperature difference between its water and the ambient air during the first experiment, the second experiment, the third experiment, and the fourth experiment. Experts may be interested in these results of my measurements of the energy parameters of my solar collector for the cases of those four experiments. We know that a solar collector can produce heat during cloudy weather, but this heat has a low temperature, which is several degrees or several tens of degrees higher than the ambient temperature. Thus, we can add a cheap plastic tank for cold water, which will be heated by our solar collectors during cloudy hours. In addition, the cold water can be heated during sunny mornings and evenings when our collectors are not able to produce heat of the high temperature we need, but they are able to heat the cold water. The heat of the water can be taken by a small heat pump, which will increase its temperature to the level we need. This idea may be interesting for large solar stations, where that plastic tank and that heat pump can increase their heat production by several tenths of percent. In addition, this idea can radically improve solar space heating of a European house due to the fact that European December and January have only several sunny days per month. Therefore, the increase in heat production of European solar collectors during December and January may be several times, but this effect in America or Asia will be noticeably less due to sunny winters. The internet can help us find such graph, which shows this heat production per one day from this flat plate solar collector, depending on this temperature difference between the liquid inside the collector pipes and the ambient air. We can notice that if the temperature difference decreases from 50 degrees to a level of 30 degrees, the heat production increases 5 times for a cloudy day, 2 times for a partly cloudy day, and 1.5 times for a sunny day. So, we should try to reduce the temperature of the liquid inside our solar collector as much as possible, and usually we can find some traditional and non-traditional opportunities to achieve this. For example, sometimes we can refuse antifreeze inside collector pipes, or we can increase the performance of the heat exchanger, which transfers heat from the antifreeze to water of our heat storage. Very often, we can achieve a noticeable decrease in the temperature of the collector liquid if we increase the volume of our heat storage. Sometimes we need to increase the performance of our pump for circulating the liquid through our solar collectors. A large solar station can use a variety of complex schemes, and for example, one of my old videos analyzed this scheme with these three heat storages for different temperatures. This is my neighbor's solar hot water system, and these mirrors give additional solar radiation to these simple solar water heaters. Obviously, the additional radiation significantly increases the efficiency of the solar heaters and the temperature of heating their water. And here we see the edge of the zone, where the solar radiation from the mirrors falls. These are my two experiments when this mirror significantly increased the heat production of these solar water heaters. The mirror of the left video is located on the south side of the solar heater, and the mirror of the right video is installed north of the heater. But it is obvious that we will achieve the maximum positive effect if we place the mirrors on both the north and south sides of our solar heater. The mirrors can increase the heat production of our solar heater several times, especially if they are not flat, but curved, as we see now. It is important to note that I did not pay anything for these mirrors, because they were made from similar mirror strips, which are garbage from glass workshops. This is another type of mirror for our solar heaters, and the price of these stainless steel sheets was only $12 per square meter. I bought this mirror mylar film from one of the Ukrainian manufacturers at a price of 20 American cents per square meter. This is one example of the use of that mirror film on the south side of a fence or a building, where the film provides additional solar radiation to this solar heater. Obviously, a similar effect will be under such walls with sheets of mirror stainless steel, or under such mirror windows. But we must understand that stagnation can destroy our solar collector if it is not ready for very high stagnation temperatures due to additional solar radiation from the mirrors. That is why similar experiments with mirrors are recommended only for a cheap homemade solar heater, for example for this.